All right, so I think I'm going to jump into the main part of this now. It's my pleasure to introduce Joonwon, who Arvind and I have been jointly advising since he joined our PhD program. He has come from a research background in programming languages and compilers from his time as an undergrad in Korea, not having worked on hardware stuff, but we convinced him to take a chance on it. Don't worry, it's just another programming language, etc. And in the course of that journey, we went way outside my comfort zone, dealing with a bunch of topics that I hadn't experienced personally before. So we were learning about those together, including the pragmatics of processors and what makes them correct. And more directly for this presentation and Joonwon's thesis, cache coherence protocols, which are at the heart of memory systems for multi-core processors. And so I learned about that along with Joonwon. I've also learned some other things from him, including the high quality diagrams that he draws, which we'll see many of in this presentation. Often his little doodles in to prepare for meetings are better than the median paper's quality of diagrams. So not to set the expectations too high, but prepare for a treat. Cache coherence protocols are a great opportunity for diagrams. And I think without further ado, I'll turn it over to Joonwon and type a chat message about what we just said about you might be videotaped.
I'll just share my screen first. Is it working?
Yep.
Okay, sorry. Thanks for such a nice introduction, Adam. I'm very excited to present one of my research projects as my thesis work today, which is about how to design and prove hardware cache coherence protocols in a more structured way. So let's get started with a very trivial statement. We all know that modern hardware designs are extremely complex. We might be much easier to reason about hardware if we were 20 years ago, just with a single core and a simple memory system, but today is very different. For instance, very recently, Apple announced its M1 SoC, a system on a chip, which consists of a lot of hardware components like CPU, GPU, memory subsystem, and so on. As we have seen the example, such a system contains a lot of hardware modules, thus it's very natural to make the concurrent execution in the system. For example, while the CPU is running, we do not want the other components to be always paused. This concurrent execution, however, does not mean the complete parallelism, meaning that each component is nothing to each other. Actually, hardware components communicate with each other to make their concurrent executions correct, meaning that every communication provides a reason why corresponding concurrent execution among modules is correct. Furthermore, I want to say that this concurrent execution does not occur only at a high level. For example, if you look inside the CPU, we have multi-cores communicating with each other to make concurrent instruction execution correct. How about a single core? If you just look inside there, even in the core, we have some instructions executed concurrently in a pipelined manner. For example, while an instruction is being executed at the exec stage, there might be another instruction being decoded at the decode stage. Among various hardware components, my thesis specifically deals with memory subsystems. Looking at the memory subsystem, it usually consists of hierarchical caches and the main memory as a root. We can also see that such memory requests are handled very concurrently in a distributed way across a cache hierarchy. As seen in this figure, for example, we may have a memory request from a core presented in red in this figure, and some caches may be involved with this request. At the same time, we may have another request from another core, which is presented in blue in this figure, and some other caches may be involved with the blue request. If there are such multiple memory requests being handled in a system, what would be the correct algorithm that makes such distributed execution correct? A cache coherence protocol is the one as a distributed protocol, and the protocol controls caches and the main memory so they are coherent. But what is the meaning of coherency in a memory subsystem? It means that the distributed execution should look like the one by an atomic memory. If I give more technical details, for any possible memory request and response sequence by the memory subsystem, if the system is correct, then the sequence should be producible by the atomic memory as the specification. I want to look into more about cache coherence protocols. Each line in the cache always consists of its own memory address, value, and so-called status. We have some example statuses here, M, S, and I. If the status is M, standing for modified, then the line is both readable and writable. If the status is S, then it is only readable. And if the status is I, which stands for invalid, the line is neither readable nor writable. One very interesting fact in designing a cache coherence protocol is that the coherence of a line is totally orthogonal, irrelevant to the coherence of others. It means that in terms of correctness, it is just fine to prove the correctness for a single line first and naturally extend it for multiple lines. So from now on, for the examples and all the explanations about the cache coherence protocols, we will only deal with the single line. Now I want to provide an example to explain why designing a cache coherence protocol is hard, even with the simple example. In this example, we have three cache objects of parent P and two children C1 and C2, where the line statuses are all S, which means that the line is just readable. And suppose a scenario in this example, the system wants to deal with two store requests, one to C1 and the other to C2. When C1 handles the blue store request first, it does not have enough permission to write the value because the status is S, which is only readable. In this case, it makes a request to the parent P with the RQM message presented in this figure to get the M status from parent. At the same time, usually it changes to its status to a so-called transient state SM to record its current status S and the next expected status M. There is actually another purpose for transient states, which is not to allow any further external requests to C1. In that sense, we can also say that the transient state also functions as a lock. I can give you the next scenario step. When the parent P gets the RQM message from C1, it needs to change the status of itself and C2 to invalid, so C1 can write and read the value with the M status, while the other caches cannot access the value. So it makes another request to C2 called an invalidation request named RQI in the figure to change the status of C2 to invalid first. At that time, P also changes its status to a transient state, usually called SD, to record its current status S, and to record that it is just in the middle of invalidation process. So we have so far only dealt with the blue request, but there is a possibility that the red request is handled in the middle of processing the blue one. Those two transactions are now interleaved in the system. So let's say that now C has started to handle the red request, which is also a store request. In the same sense, C2 changes its status to transient state SM and makes the output message RQM to P to get the M status. A transient state of P is very crucial here to maintain coherence because it cannot handle the red RQM because of its transient state. So it is acting like a lock again. If P were able to handle the red RQM message, then it might lead to an incoherent state where C1 and C2 both have the M status. So in this case, the only possible next scenario is C2 to handle this invalidation request RQI and to respond with RSI to the parent. There is a warning in using transient state here. Even if it is in the transient state, it still should be able to handle requests from the parent, even if it is locked. So in this case, it changes its transient state from SM to IM to say that now the status is I and the expected next status is still M. So in this case, we can say that the invalidation request should not be blocked by this transient state. One might wonder here in this figure why there are three channels between the parent and a child. Especially we have two upward channels, one for requests and the other for responses. This scenario says that indeed the two upward channels are necessary to avoid the deadlock. If we had a single upward channel, then deadlock might happen because P cannot handle the red RQM message because it is in the transient state. And P also cannot handle the invalidation response RSI because it will not be the first element of the queue. So now the only possible next step is P to handle the invalidation response from C2 and finally to respond back to C1 to grant the M status. At that time, P changes its status to I. If we proceed the rest of the steps, we get the following state, which is now coherent. C2 is the only one that has the M status, so it can write and read the value, whereas the other caches have invalid status, meaning that they cannot access the value. So what we can learn from this example is that, of course, even this simple example is quite complex, but we want to emphasize that transient states and the three channels used in this system are very crucial to make interleavings between red and blue transactions correct. So we've just seen that designing a cache coherence protocol, even a simple setting, is still non-trivial. Then how can we convince ourselves that our design is correct? We may want to use some ordinary verification techniques like testing or bounded model checking. And actually these are quite popular in industry. However, it is well known that such ordinary verification techniques generally have bad coverage, so they may miss those sort of bugs. Formal verification is also quite popular in hardware industry. And there are two mainstream techniques, model checking and theorem proving. So model checking has been dominant in the industry, and basically it checks all the reachable states to prove desired properties. But the typical problem in model checking is so-called st- state space explosion, that sometimes it requires too much time and memory to explore all the reachable states. In order to overcome this explosion, especially by interleavings, state-of-the-art model checkers have developed so-called non-interference lemmas to ensure that interleavings in the system are safe, which in turn reduces the size of state space by constraining the reachable states. However, the use of non-interference lemmas in model checking has some drawbacks as well. First of all, lemmas must be designed and proven per protocol manually by user. Furthermore, it is even hard to be sure if the lemmas are effective enough to indeed constrain all the reachable states. I use a theorem prover for my thesis work to reason about interleavings better. In order to do that, we need to take a full advantage of theorem proving, which I believe is that we can state a general theorem with rich logic provided by a theorem prover, prove this theorem once, just one time, and apply this theorem for multiple times. If we apply this philosophy to verification of cache-coherence protocol to deal with interleavings better, we have four steps. First of all, we formalize the most general form of non-interference, which I will call serializability. Second, we want to find abstract conditions that imply this non-interference, and we want to prove this implication from abstract conditions to non-interference just once. And lastly, we want to use the theorem repeatedly for various cache-coherence protocols. With this motivation, we have developed a framework called Himeola, which is embedded in the Koch proof assistant to design, prove, and synthesize cache-coherence protocols in a more structured way. It provides four things. First of all, a protocol transition system as underlying state transition system. On top of this system, we'll define a domain-specific language, DSL, to describe protocols more easily, where any expressible protocol satisfies the most general non-interference that I will call serializability. And we will get into that with some more technical details. We will also provide a novel invariant proof method that only requires considering execution histories without any interleavings on top of the serializability property. And lastly, we will provide a compilation and synthesis toolchain to run Himeola protocols on FPGA. And we introduce the protocol transition systems first. A system is the highest level component in the protocol transition system, and it consists of objects and ordered message channels. There is an object in a system which contains its local state and rules. A rule is a basic unit to make state transition steps in the system. It generally takes input messages from some message channel, checks its own precondition, and makes an object state transition if the precondition holds, and produces output messages in queue to some other channel. With this syntax setting, we can now describe the semantics of the protocol transition system. A state of the system is composed of an object state, and the state transition step happens only by a single rule. But actually, if we think about actual hardware implementations, multiple rules can be executed at the same cycle. This is different from what we just assumed, that only a single rule can make a transition step. Here, we assume the so-called one read at a time semantics, which claims that any concurrent execution of rules can be interpreted as sequential execution of rules. In that case, it is safe to assume that a state transition is always made by a single rule. I want to mention here that such an assumption is very critical in hardware designs, especially with the rule-based hardware description languages like BlueSpec. With this syntax and semantic settings, we define simulation as the correctness criterion. It requires to establish a simulation relation R and to prove that the relation is preserved through every state transient step in implementation. And here, the external behavior is either incoming messages from the external world or outgoing messages to the external world. While proving simulation relation, we sometimes need some invariance to prove to constrain the states, possible reachable states in the implementation. So that was the underlying setting as a protocol transition system. And now we talk about the Himeola DSL defined on top of protocol transition system. Before we introduce what this DSL is, we want to give an example while describing some conventional protocol. Let's suppose a scenario that we already have seen in the example. Say that an L1 cache gets a memory write request, but this cache just has the S status, so it is only readable. As I already mentioned, in a conventional protocol description, we first need to check whether the line is in transition, and we change the status to so-called a transient state SM to record the current status S and the next expected status M. If we use the Himeola DSL, we don't need to explicitly check in transition, and we don't need to use any transient state. So looking at this rule template, for example, we have some precondition annotated as requires, saying that the line of status of the line is less than or equal to S, which is nothing to the transient state or in transition checks. And we have a transition function defined with the annotation transition. And in this case, we are not making any state transition, but just outputs the message with RQM. Let me just give one more example. Let's say that now an L1 cache gets an invalidation request while in a transient state SM. If we just deal with the conventional protocol, if we just describe in a conventional way, then we need to check that whether the line is in transition. And we need to also check that if the transient state is SM, then we change the transient state to IM, now saying that the current status just became I, and the next expected status is still M. If we use the Himeola DSL, again, we don't need to use any intransient checks, or we don't need to use any transient states at all. So how that is happening? Instead of transient states, Himeola DSL provides an abstract locking mechanism called uplocks and downlocks. And we can interpret some transient states with stable statuses and these locks. For example, a transient state SM in a conventional description can be interpreted as stable status S and uplock in Himeola. And transient state SD, or the parent in invalidation process, can be interpreted as a stable status S and downlock. One more thing I want to emphasize here is that if you use the Himeola DSL, those proper locks, either unlock or downlock, is automatically set by the language. So if you just look at this rule template again, we cannot see anything setting or releasing uplocks or downlocks. And specifically for this rule template, it checks if the line is unlocked and implicitly sets that unlock. we have just seen a couple of rule examples. The DSL actually provides 9 rule templates to cover usual request and response patterns in practice. Again, we have this rule template, and I can say again that this rule template checks if the line is locked or not, and implicitly sets this or not. And all the other rule templates are doing it in a proper way. So we just introduced the DSL. Now we understand that from the perspective of the user, it is maybe much easier to design the cache-coherence protocol with this rule template because we don't need to worry about transient state and intransient checks. But what is the guarantee, formal guarantee, if we use such DSL? The payoff of using DSL is that any expressible protocol by the Himmler DSL always satisfies the serializability property. If I give the formal definition of serializability, the system S is serializable if and only if for any interleaved history, there always exists a legal sequential history that reaches the same state. We can just do-
I have a question.
Yes.
So this statement in the previous slide always confuses me slightly. Does it mean it's impossible to write a wrong protocol in Hemiola?
It is. So we might want to have some properties to prove the correctness. And I regard the serializability as the one of the main properties we want to prove the correctness. So for example, even if we are using the proper logs to make the system serializable, there is still a chance to design the buggy system, buggy memory subsystem. For example, let's say that we just got an invalidation request from the parent, but the child does not change its status to I, but something like S and N while taking this invalidation request. But this bug is nothing to do with interleaving subsystem. This bug is just about the bug that once we wanted to make the status I because of this invalidation request, but we just make the typo that now the status is S or M, which is wrong.
We'll come back to this later, but let me just record my concern again. The concern is the following. Usually serializability of reads and writes is such a strong property that it'll almost guarantee correctness unless something very weird is going on, right? So by saying here, I think you mean serializability in a very technical sense that you will define the notion of a transaction associated with a read and write. And then you will say those transactions are serializable, but it's possible that the transaction itself is wrong.
Yep, that's right.
Okay, so there will still be some burden for me to prove that the protocol I wrote in Hemiola is still correct.
That's right.
Okay, right. Good.
And I will also introduce the way how to design and prove a single transaction on top of serializability using some more novel invariant proof method.
Good.
Mm-hmm. If I can ask a follow-up question, so is the serializability at the level of reads and writes or the sub-operations involved in the reads and writes?
I think I did not get the question correctly.
So each read and write has several steps in it, right?
That's right.
So is the serializability at the level of those steps or at the level of the complete read and write?
Oh, so we define a transaction as the complete handling of read and store requests. And serializability said that we can separate all the transactions, interleave transactions.
Got it. Okay, thank you.
So let me talk about the current problem in conventional description. In terms of design, as I already said, we should consider all possible transient states. And in terms of verification, I also said that we need non-interference lemmas per transient state and per protocol, manually given by the user. However, if you use the Himmler-Diesel, we are no better. In terms of design, I said that on-offs and down-offs are automatically set and released. So in protocol descriptions, we can just use table statuses without any needs of transient states. In terms of verification, if we use the DSL, then we get the serializability property for free. In describing the protocol, we can just prove the correctness of each transaction without worrying any interference by transactions. So we had this example where red and blue transactions are interleaved. And we want to provide an example here again to illustrate more about this benefit. So this is the legal sequential history in the system where we handle the blue request first. And once it is finished, then we start to handle red transaction. If the system is serializable, then we should be able to always find such a legal sequential history that reaches the same state. So here's the biggest contribution of Himmler, saying that any protocol defined with the Himmler DSL always satisfies serializability. More specifically, this on-tree predicate says that a system S is defined on a tree topology T and uses the three channels mechanism I mentioned in the example. We have good rules predicates saying that any rule in S is always defined using the rule template. If we have these two predicates, then we can say that now the system S is serializable. So this is indeed the biggest contribution, and it has the biggest proof inside the framework. The proof is quite big. It has the 24,000 lines of code in Coq. And we really spent a lot of time discovering the minimal and abstract conditions that imply serializability. For example, locking mechanism and the three channel system. But we want to emphasize our philosophy again. We want to formalize the most general form of non-interference, which is serializability now. And we provided the abstract conditions on tree and good rules. And those are very abstract in that they are not coupled to any specific protocols. And we proved this implication just once. And we used the theorem repeatedly for various protocols. So that was the overall introduction of DSL. Now we move on to the next step, how to design and prove some invariants to check that a single transaction execution is correct or not. So in verifying cache coherence protocols, it is quite common to state an invariant like, what is the desired property if there is a certain message in the system? And we call it a predicate message. I will give some example of the predicate messages with this sequential history, especially with the blue transaction. So let's say that we're at the moment where P requested the invalidation request to C2, and C2 is about to handle that. C2 changes its status to I, and we set the predicate message for the invalidation response RSI, claiming that status of the C2 is I. This is very trivial to prove because we already know that C2 just changes its status to I. Next step is P to handle this invalidation response and makes the RSM message back to C1. Now we have two facts that P changed its status to I, and we have previous predicate message claiming that the status of C2 is I. And what we want for the existence of message RSM to C1 is that now the status of P and C2 are both I. We can easily prove that because of these two facts, saying that now the status of P is I and the predicate message for invalidation response. We indeed wanted to have this predicate message for RSM to C1 because when C1 wants to set its status to M, we need to ensure that all the other caches are invalid. So in this case, we can say that predicate messages help prove conventional invariance. I want to give one more fact saying that predicate messages get very complicated without serializability property. So let's say that we have the same predicate message, RSM to C1, claiming that the status of C2 and P are both I. But let's assume that we now have another RSM message in the red, in figure, which is going to C2. When C2 handles that, it changes its status to M, and it breaks the predicate message for RSM because it claimed that the status of C2 should be I. So in this case, we need to have much more complicated formal predicate message for RSM, saying that actually the red RSM message cannot exist in the system while the blue RSM message to C1 is existing in the system. And we may need some more predicates like that, regarded as non-interference per message. So let me give you the summary of using DSL and its benefits as serializability and predicate messages. I want to just emphasize that in terms of verification, if you use the Himmler DSL, we get serializability for free. And on top of this property, we can use predicate messages much more easily to deal with the correctness of a single transaction.
So one more question. So does it mean that predicate messages are protocol specific?
That is right.
Good, good. Thank you.
Maybe just as a clarifying question. So should I think of predicate messages kind of like the post conditions and Hoare logic?
Yep, that is correct. So especially if you're dealing with a single transaction on top of serializability, we can just regard predicate message as the Hoare triple in sequential program without loops, which is now very trivial.
And then using the predicate message to form another message is like the semicolon rule in Hoare logic.
That's right.
It doesn't sound quite right because we can have a bunch of messages present simultaneously in different parts of the system. And some of the reasoning does involve using your knowledge about that. It's not sequential really, right?
Interesting. Oh, yeah. The way I was thinking of it is I was trying to sort of make the analogy with something like CSL, which you would use to also do sequential-like reasoning about concurrent software, and some adequacy theorem behind the scenes proves that, yes, you can reorder things as long as you follow the concurrent separation logic rules. So I was curious actually to see what the differences are, but maybe I'll wait to the end to ask that.
Yeah, well, what I want to say here is that it is not just like the sequential program, but the reasoning is almost as easy as dealing with a sequential program without loads, because we can just follow the single transaction and do the reasoning like Hoare triple.
Thanks.
Okay. Now we move on to the actual case studies to deal with hierarchical cache coherence protocols. So on top of the Himmler framework, we designed and proved hierarchical MSI and MASI cache coherence protocols. And I want to emphasize that the designs and correctness proofs take system topology as a parameter. For example, if we have this form of tree, then we will get the memory system consisting of 4 L1 caches, 2 L2 caches, and last level cache, and the main memory and we will get the correctness proof for that for free. So before diving into the actual proof of such hierarchical cache coherence protocols, I want to recall again about the our correctness criteria, invariants, and predicate messages. So we said that the simulation is the correctness criteria, and invariants are often required to prove the simulation. And additionally, we saw that, with example, predicate messages help prove conventional invariants. I want to give just a single example of invariant required in hierarchical cache coherence protocols, both in MSI and MESI invariants, which is called the exclusiveness invariant. It is simply saying that if a cache object has status M, then the other caches are all invalid. And this is regarded as one of the main conventional invariants required to prove hierarchical cache coherence protocols. But here, I want to recall again that it is very difficult to design and prove this kind of invariance without serializability. Let's suppose that, again, we have two RSM messages, one to C1 and the other to C2. If we handle these two messages, then we will have both C1 and C2 having the state of M, which breaks this exclusive invariant, because we now have the two caches that have the state of M. Which means that we need to make the invariant without serializability more fine-grained, at least containing that the two RSM messages cannot be in the same system at the same time. So now we want to deal with some predicate messages to prove this exclusiveness invariant. We first specifically need this predicate message for RSM to an L1 cache, saying that for all the other caches, which is not L1, this L1 cache, are all invalid. This predicate message can be generalized for all the other RSM messages, claiming that now all the other caches, which is outside the subtree of C0 in this figure, are all invalid. And it is quite easy to prove the implication from this general notion of RSM predicate message to the one for L1 cache. I can give one more example, which is saying that sometimes we need predicate messages to prove another predicate message. And this is in the state transition for P, where P is changing its status to I by handling some invalidation messages, invalidation responses from children. So each predicate message for RSI, invalidation response, is saying that the subtree of the child, caches in the subtree of the child are all invalid. We can collect all the predicate messages for RSI and the state transition of the parent to say that now the desired predicate message for RSM is what I just mentioned. So that was the actual use of predicate messages in practical cache coherence protocols. And lastly, I want to provide a compilation and synthesis toolchain to run our Himmler protocols on actual FPGAs. Himmler as a framework also provides a protocol compiler where the source is a single line Himmler protocol. So we already assume that we have been dealing with the single line protocol, but actual target by this protocol compiler is a multi-line Kami hardware implementation. I want to give some introduction to Kami. This is a hardware verification framework built in Coq, equipped with its own HDL and proof automation tools. So the HDL inside Kami is also rule-based like full spec. The compilation is very natural from Himura protocol to HDL, this Kami HDL. It also has a hardware synthesis toolchain, borrowing the toolchain from BlueSpec. And I want to emphasize that we can later use this Himura protocols and their correctness proofs within larger Kami proofs, including processors. This protocol compiler uses some pre-built hardware components in Kami. One of them is the VRAM-based caches. And we have some module controlling MIS status holding registers as hardware implementations of unlocks and unlocks. We have a designated module for victim lines, replacement policies, and most importantly, we have a pre-built pipeline cache controller to deal with input messages concurrently. So this is the brief diagram of the protocol compiler. For a given Himura cache object that may consist of some Himura rules where each rule is dequeuing input and enqueuing output and sometimes getting some line status value and set and releases unlock and downlock at the same time. So this is in the protocol description. What protocol compiler builds is a corresponding Kami module, which is pipeline. So as seen in this figure, we have the first stage, which is taking some inputs. And we always check the MFHR's module to check that whether these input messages can be handled or not now. We have some next stages to access some VRAM-based caches. And lastly, we have the actual execution stage with some compiled Kami rules from Himura rules. And at this stage, we are making some outputs. So with this compiled Kami modules, we did some evaluation of Himura protocols, and we specifically used our MESI case study protocol. And we instantiated two protocols called HIM3 and HIM2. HIM3 is three-level, which consists of 4 32 kilobyte L1 caches, 2 L2 caches, and a single last level cache, where HIM2 is two-level, consisting of just 4 L1 caches and 1 last level cache. And particularly, we compare the performance of HIM3 and HIM2 with an existing BlueSpec implementation with KOO with the same cache configuration as HIM2. We use the BlueSpec simulator to measure the performance. And for the evaluation, we designed 4 artificial workloads that make random requests, but mimic some temporal and spatial locality of memory accesses. And we measured the performance by counting the number of transactions performed in 0.5 million simulation cycles. As you can see the result seen in the graph in the left side, we can say that the protocols compiled from protocol compiler HIM3 and HIM2 are quite competitive with the existing BlueSpec implementation. We also synthesized HIM2 and HIM3 on Xilinx Vertex 7 VC707 FPGA, and we performed tandem verification on FPGA, covering over 1 billion memory requests for each protocol with a random workload and a reference memory to check its correctness. So that was the part for compilation and synthesis for Himura protocols. And now I can give some future work. As I already said that we have the protocol compiler. And one of the major future work is to prove the correctness of the compiler, which can be also regarded as a proof for a cache coherence protocol implementation at the low level. We have some other major future work as well. One of them is proving the liveness property, which may contain deadlock, live lock, and starvation freedom. And I want to emphasize here that such liveness property must be verified at a low level. And we also want to extend the rule template to cover more communication patterns. For example, we want to add the sibling-to-sibling communication, which is quite well used in optimized state-of-the-art cache-coherence protocols. And in this case, we must extend the serializability proof and related invariance proofs for such additional rule templates. Yeah, and here's the conclusion. We built the Himmel framework in CockProof Assistant to design and verify hierarchical cache-coherence protocols in a more structured way. And the framework provides a DSL which allows the user not to worry about any incorrect interleavings among transactions. And formally speaking, any protocol defined by the DSL always satisfies serializability property. Invariants are now much easier to design and prove in Himmler by using predicate message on top of serializability. And lastly, we designed and proved various hierarchical protocols and demonstrated that Himmler indeed uses the design and proof by using predicate messages.
Okay, thank you, Joonwon.